Hello and welcome to my another recording session about design patterns in Java. Today I would try to explain another interesting design pattern, which is chains of responsibility. Who am I? Here is my information. My name is Alexander. I'm a freelancer out of Germany. Here you have my contact information. What kind of services I provide to my clients, software development, creating automatic unit tests, doing requirements engineering for my clients, advising my clients, helping people to get hired by some German company. So if you're interested, you have here my contact information. And now to the main topic, we'll discuss design patterns head first from the book Head First Design Patterns. I do this friendly reference because from this book I get main of information. And sorry about that. And furthermore, I discussing the advantages and the design. So basically, how it works. You have a chain of different type of handlers. I took example from the site tutorials point. Sorry. The example itself is all about different type of handlers. And I will show you right now, but the major idea, you have this chain, and depending of the message which need to be handled, one of the handlers are activated. The book Head First Design Patterns itself, it describes following. It decouples sender of the request and its receiver. That means that the chain of responsibility decouples the sender of the request and its receiver. Simplifies your object because it doesn't have to know the chain structure and keep direct reference to its members. Allows you to add or remove responsibilities dynamically by changing the members of order to the chain. So pretty obvious what this design pattern does. Now I will show you my code. Here's the code. Here you have the example. Basically, let me show you UML diagram. I forget it always. Here is the UML diagram. You have an example for the chain of responsibility. One is an abstract logger. Other one, console logger, error logger, file logger. And then you have your caller, which is chain pattern demo. In my case, it just I'm using just as in the test. I have written JUnit test for that, and you will actually then look it up on GitHub. It's got available on GitHub already. And here it goes like this. So, and basically, the test itself is self-explanatory. I'm checking that I can create the given handler. Actually, it's a logger, file logger, error logger, console logger. And then I will show you the classes. Abstract logger. From this logger, all of the other loggers inherit methods log message set next logger. And here I have exactly next element in the chain of responsibility. And here I have method which I need to implement in each of the logger. So I have here console logger, have here error logger, I have here file logger, and I have here write operation. Basically obvious stuff. And what I do, here is actually the example itself. So I have my error logger object. I'm setting the next logger, which is file logger object. And then I'm calling the error logger object log message, with this given type of the message. Let me clean my output. Oh, it's already clean. So let me put it like here. So I have once again setting my next logger and then setting the log type of the log. And let's try what happens. So for the file logger, this is information. And this is what I get when I have information. This actually, this info, it's a number. When you look abstract logger, it's a number one. Then I have number two and number three. So then I have, and what I told you earlier, you always need to have this chain in mind, because each handler should act only when it's have one special parameter. So each handler responds to only to one special parameter. So file logger did respond to the info, which actually was expected. Then I have my error logger, debug level information, and then I have my file logger once again, and then I have once again error logger, and then file logger. Yeah. And now let's discuss advantages of this kind of pattern. So is actually this type of design pattern used in the Windows system? This is what book tells us. To handle events like mouse clicks and keyboard events. Execution of the request isn't guaranteed. It may fall off the end of the chain if no object handles it. This can be advantage or disadvantage. Can be hard to observe and debug at runtime. Yeah, this is what we actually experienced. I can only say about this design patterns. I actually don't see these design patterns a lot in the production. Maybe at some legacy projects when I get to it, but most times I don't see it. I see kind of problematic the handling of the requests through the chain. So if at one time one of the handlers was changed and the message to which the handler should respond did changed, it can be so that at one point you have such message which previously was handled by one of the handlers, but then it cannot be handled because there are no handler which can catch this message. So it can be pretty complicated. My best advice, have unit tests, like not like this. This is just to show execution, but things like that you actually expect to see from this logger is a special event that it can be erased from the logger. And I'm sure that in this little time which I have, that I'm able to produce such event to which the logger can respond. But anyway, use common sense with this type of design pattern and apply where you have, where you have sense that you need to use such type of design pattern. I agree with book completely, because if you have windowing type system which you need to handle, and you have events which like mouse clicks or keyboard events, then it should probably would make sense for you. If you don't have such case but you wish to have such handler, write test first. Make sure that you pass each of the handler which you have in your chain, and then pretty obvious that it will work in the future. Otherwise, if one of the handler classes will be changed, then you will probably get some problems later on. And that's it for me. Thank you all.